ಅಮೆರಿಕದೊಳಗ ಟೆಲಿವಿಷನ್ ಒಳಗ ಒಬ್ಬ ಡೇವಿಡ್ ಲೆಟರ್ಮನ್ ಅಂತ ಬಹಳ ಫೇಮಸ್ ಇಂಟರ್ವ್ಯೂವರ್, ಅವನೊಂದ್ ಶೋ ಅದ. ಆ ಶೋದ ಹೆಸರು ಏನಪ್ಪಾ ಅಂದ್ರ ಮೈ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಗೆಸ್ಟ್ ನೀಡ್ಸ್ ನೋ ಇಂಟ್ರೊಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಅಂತ. ಅದ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಅವ ಹಂಗ ಮಾಡ್ತಾನ. ಆದ್ರೆ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಏನಂತಾರ ಅಂದ್ರ ಪ್ರತಿ ಗೆಸ್ಟ್ಗೂ ಇದನ್ನ ಅಂತಾರ, ಅವ್ರ ಗೆಸ್ಟ್ ನೀಡ್ಸ್ ನೋ ಇಂಟ್ರೊಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ಮತ್ತೊಂದು 10 ಮಿನಿಟ್ ಅವ್ರನ್ನ ಇಂಟ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರ. ಆದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಅವ್ರ ಮೊದಲು ಹೇಳಿದ ಕರೇನೋ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಹೇಳಿದ ಕರೇನೋ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗಂಗಿಲ್ಲ. ಓಕೆ, ಡೋಂಟ್ ವರಿ ಅಟ್ ಆಲ್, ಐ ಆಮ್ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಹೈಯರ್ ಎಜುಕೇಶನ್ ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿ ಫ್ಯಾಮಿಲಿ ಅಂಡ್ ಐ ಟ್ರೂಲಿ ಡೋಂಟ್ ನೀಡ್ ಎನಿ ಇಂಟ್ರೊಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಎನಿ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ಯಾಲಿಟಿ. ನಾನೇ ಹೇಳ್ಕೊತೇನೆ ನನ್ನ ಬಗ್ಗೆ, ನಾನೇ ಹೇಳ್ಕೊಂಡು ಬಿಡ್ತೀನಿ. ಓಕೆ, ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ನಾನು ಧಾರವಾಡದಾಗ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಮತ್ತೆ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕನು ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಆಲ್ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ 50 ಇಯರ್ಸ್ ಆಯ್ತು. ನಾನು ಬಿ ಎಸ್ ಸಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಕಾಲೇಜ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ಮೇಲೆ 72ದಾಗ ಬಿಟ್ಟದ್ದು, ಈಗ ಇದುವರೆಗೆ ಹೊರಗಾದೀನಿ. ಅಫ್ಕೋರ್ಸ್ ಧಾರವಾಡಕ್ಕೆ ಆಗ್ಲೆಲ್ಲ ಬರ್ತಿರ್ತೇನೆ. ನಮ್ಮ ತಂದೆ ತಾಯಿ ತಾಯಿ ತೀರ್ಕೊಂಡ್ರು ಹೋದ ವರ್ಷ, ತಂದೆ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ, ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿರ್ಬೋದು ಚನ್ವೀರ್ ಕಣ್ವಿ ಅವರು. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಆವಾಗ ಮತ್ತೆ ಹೈಯರ್ ಎಜುಕೇಶನ್ ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿಗೂ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಫಿಸಿಕಲಿ ಯಾವಾಗ ಇದ್ದು ಆಫ್ಲೈನ್ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ಸ್ ಶುರು ಆಗಿದ್ದಾಗಿನಿಂದನು ಆಲ್ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ 2018 ನವೆಂಬರ್ ಡಿಸೆಂಬರ್ ನಿಂದ ಹಿಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಅಟ್ ಲೀಸ್ಟ್ ಒಂದು 10-15 ಬಾರಿ ಆದರೂ ನಾನು ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ ಮಾಡಿರ್ಬೋದು. ಅಂಡ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಬಿನ್ ಅ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಅಡ್ಮೈರರ್ ಆಫ್ ಬೋತ್ ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಡೈನಾಮಿಕ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಶಿವಪ್ರಸಾದ್, ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಹಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಬಿನ್ ಡೂಯಿಂಗ್ ಅ ವಂಡರ್ಫುಲ್ ಸರ್ವಿಸ್ ಟು ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್. ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಈಗ ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ನ್ಯೂ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಪಾಲಿಸಿ, ಓಲ್ಡ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಪಾಲಿಸಿ, ಫ್ಯೂಚರಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಪಾಲಿಸಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಾರ, ಆದ್ರೆ ಅದನ್ನ ಇಂಪ್ಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡೋದು ಹೆಂಗ? ಆ ಇಂಪ್ಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಒನ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸೇ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಫೀಚರ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅದ್ರೊಳಗ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಏನು ಡೈಮೆನ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಅದಾವು, ಅದನ್ನ ಅದು ಆ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಆಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಏನ್ ಅದಾವಲ್ಲ ಅದ್ರೊಳಗ ಟೀಚರ್ಸ್ ಅನ್ನ ಟ್ರೈನ್ ಮಾಡೋದು. ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ ಆಲ್ ಎಜುಕೇಶನ್ ಈಸ್ ಬಿಂಗ್ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಡ್ ಥ್ರೂ ಟೀಚರ್ಸ್. ಓಕೆ, ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಸ್ಟಡಿ ಏನ್ ಮಾಡ್ದ ಅದು, ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಟುಡೇ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಅ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಟ್. ಓಕೆ, ವಿ ಹೋಪ್ ಟು ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಇಟ್, ಮೋಟಿವೇಟ್ ದ ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ಸ್, ಬಟ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಟೀಚರ್ಸ್ ಹೂ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಪ್ಲೇ ದ ಮೇನ್ ರೋಲ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್. ಸೊ ಇಫ್ ದ ಟೀಚರ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಟ್ರೈನ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ದಟ್ ನ್ಯೂ ವೇ, ನ್ಯೂ ಥಿಂಕಿಂಗ್, ವೈಲ್ ರಿಟೈನಿಂಗ್ ಆಲ್ ದ ಗುಡ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ ಓಲ್ಡ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್, ವಾಟ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ನ್ಯೂ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ಟ್ರೈನ್ ಆಗ್ಲಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅದು ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಇಂಪಾಸಿಬಲ್ ಟು ಬ್ರಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಎನಿ ಚೇಂಜ್ ಅಂತೇಳಿ ಅವರು ಈ ನ್ಯೂ ಎಜುಕೇಶನ್ ಪಾಲಿಸಿ ಶುರು ಆಗಿದ್ದು ರಿಲೀಸ್ ಆಗಿದ್ದು 2020 ಒಳಗ, ಇಫ್ ಐ ರಿಮೆಂಬರ್ ರೈಟ್, ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಮಿಡ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಕೋವಿಡ್. ಆದ್ರೆ ಇವರು ಅದಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಒಂದು 5 ವರ್ಷದ ಹಿಂದೆನೆ ಆ ಕೆಲಸ ಶುರು ಮಾಡಿಬಿಟ್ಟಿದ್ರು. ಸೊ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಅಡ್ಮೈರರ್ ಆಫ್ ದಟ್ ದಟ್ ವರ್ಕ್. And I also appreciate the initiative taken by Government of Karnataka in establishing such an academy. Yakandre ee tarada academy bare yav state nallu illa. Okay, for higher education and college education ellaru en tilkotara andre school teachers ge training beku, college teachers ge enu bekagilla, which is a very wrong thing according to me, because I have been to colleges and universities here and as well as abroad. And everybody needs training and orientation on teaching. Just because you're a postgraduate or a PhD or a good researcher doesn't mean you're a good teacher. I've seen very many great scientists also who were terrible teachers. So it's not automatic. It is an art and a science. So adannella nanenu hechige helak hogangilla. Prasad avaru matta avardu entire team is prepared a detailed program about that. Ega, coming to the subject proper, namaga bhala innu time illa. I think 12:30 we have to finish, alla?
Yes sir.
So that means we have less than an hour. Nanu quickly I'll come to the topic. Only there has been a small mishap. Enandre, ನಾನು ಈ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ ಸಲುವಾಗಿ ಪ್ರಿಪೇರ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದು ಒಂದು ವಾಟ್ ಐ ವುಡ್ ಸೇ ವಾಸ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಗುಡ್ ಪವರ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್, ಅದನ್ನು ಸೇವ್ ಮಾಡಿ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಕಳಿಸ್ಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಅದು ಸೇವ್ ಆಗಿಲ್ಲ. ಸೊ ಓಲ್ಡ್ ವರ್ಷನ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಗಾನ್ ಟು ಯು. ಓಕೆ, So that created a little bit of confusion. Now I have sent you the, you can say, something between old and the new version. Adunna, so in case there is some problem with the internet, adunna new hakkondo now audio dolga maataduvudu sandarbha bantandra alli kalasene agale nimage. But so I'll make do. The absence of few slides in that, I'll make do with my extempore talking. Okay. So first thing, Andhra, I'll just share my screen with you. Okay, can you, I think you're, 1 minute. Okay. Anyway, I was trying to make it full screen and yako agvalto. So let's make do with what we have now. So side nage en panel bandadala adannu just ignore madre. ಈಗ ನಾನು ಈ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ಯಾಕೆ ಚೂಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದೆ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಮೇನ್ಲಿ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಟು ಅಟ್ರಾಕ್ಟ್ ಯುವರ್ ಅಟೆನ್ಷನ್. ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಐ ಆಮ್ ನಾಟ್ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಪರ್ಸನಾಲಿಟೀಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಐದರ್ ಜವಾಹರ್ಲಾಲ್ ನೆಹರು ಆರ್ ಶ್ರೀಮತಿ ಇಂದಿರಾ ಗಾಂಧಿ. ದೇರ್ ಪರ್ಸನಾಲಿಟೀಸ್, ದೇರ್ ಇಡಿಯಾಲಜಿ ಆರ್ ದೇರ್ ಆಕ್ಟಿವಿಟೀಸ್ ಆಸ್ ಪ್ರೈಮ್ ಮಿನಿಸ್ಟರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ, ಐ ಆಮ್ ನಾಟ್ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ದಟ್. I'm interested in the ground reality. Okay. I'm not interested in manifestos and professed ideologies, professed beliefs. I want to see what is happening to the mass of the Indian people, what is happening in the economy, what is happening in politics and so on. So, it has become a common characterization that before 91, India was socialist. And normally they associate it with Jawaharlal Nehru and then later Mrs. Gandhi. Okay. So though Mrs. Gandhi passed away in 84, but still till 91 andre avaru yenu frame madidru adu nadittu and that was socialist. So on what basis is this this kind of a conclusion drawn? Bala mandi martara normally, not only in the TV talk shows and all that, but even some so called historians, modern historians who are writing about the modern history of India, post-independent history of India and all that, even they very casually call that as socialist. Whereas now there is, we got liberation from 91 and liberalization idella aitu. Adarinda we were liberated from socialism and now we have market economics and ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲಿಸಮ್ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ಒಂದು ಐಡಿಯಾ ಅದ. ಆದ್ರೆ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ವಾಟ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಬೇಸಿಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್? ಬೇಸಿಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಕೆಲವು ಕಾಮನ್ ಏನಂತಾರ ರೀಸನಿಂಗ್ ಏನ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ವಿಚ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಡೆಮಾನ್ಸ್ಟ್ರೇಟ್ ದಟ್ ದಟ್ ರೀಸನಿಂಗ್ ಈಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಸೂಪರ್ಫಿಷಿಯಲ್. ಬಟ್ ಬೇಸಿಕಲಿ ದ ವೇ ದ ಪೀಪಲ್ ಥಿಂಕ್ ದಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಸೋಷಿಯಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ number one, there was a large public sector and there was a what is also called mixed economy. So hinga agidrinda innu kelavaru en heltara swalpa innu mund hogi idu socialist nu alri capitalist nu alri idu something mixed anta. In fact not only there was at one time some political parties in India characterized it as non-capitalist path of development, and even Khrushchev, who was the general secretary of the Communist Party of Soviet Union and its head, literally, even he called it as a non-capitalist path. Okay, so hingagi adu popular aato, non-capitalist. Idu capitalism alla, socialism alla antare. But that is another argument that it was neither capitalist nor socialist. Amale innondu yakandre, because the state is playing such a major role in the production of commodities as well as in the services and commodities as well as in the distribution of these things. Okay, distribution of goods and services and distribution of income and so on. So adakka, since state is playing such a large role, so it is socialist. This is one argument. Okay. Second, innondandra, there were measures taken very early to curb capitalism, to control capitalism. For example, licensing madidru. Without government license, you could not start many industries in many sectors. Therefore, it was anti-capitalist. And by, you know, implication, it was socialist. Okay. Amele innu mundhodra, especially under Mrs. Gandhi, there were several moves to what were called nationalizations. Okay. Nationalization of banks, nationalization of insurance companies, nationalization of coal mining, nationalization of all the petroleum refineries. Ivella agiddu 69, 70, 71, 72. Okay, 73. So, our period, Ivella nationalizations are under Mrs. Gandhi. So, Adrinda, nationalization is against capitalism, Adrinda, Idella socialism. This is another argument. One more argument is that, because in the foreign policy and in many other things, both in trade, commerce, as foreign policy, defense, etc., they aligned themselves with Soviet Union, which was socialist. Therefore, you know, they were socialist. Idu one argument. So, ivella arguments basically can be shown to be false on the ground. Okay. Yakandra, they come from a fundamental misconception that the role of the state is zero in capitalism. And it's only in socialism that state controls industry and state controls various things. This is actually totally wrong. Adukke, in fact, I had a full slide which unfortunately has got lost while saving it. Enapandra, if you take today, what is the public sector amount, number of people employed in public sector in the countries of the world? Okay, it is available. You can just go to Google and Google public sector, share of public sector in the world, in the economy, in countries of the world, and Wikipedia page. So what they are describing there is the number of people employed in the public sector compared to the total number of people employed in the country. Adan nodidre, you'll be surprised that if you take the top 10 economies in the world, number one is United States, as you know. It has today, according to the latest data by IMF, by 2021, it is still the richest country in terms of total GDP. That is nearly $22 trillion. Next comes China, which is $16.7 trillion. Okay, and then there is Japan, and then Germany, then UK, India, then France, Canada, Italy, South Korea. These roughly they constitute the top 10 countries today, in the more or less in that order. Okay. So you top 10 economies, what percentage of people are working in the public sector, you'll be surprised that according to ILO data, that is International Labour Organization, as you know, which keeps track of people in the labor sector, they follow all the statistics in that. If you see that the percentage of people in America, working in the public sector is 13%, according to ILO data. There are other estimates which take it to 19% and all that. Okay, but ILO data says 13%. And UK is about 20%. Canada is about 20%. Okay, and Japan is about 8%. And France is also quite large, is about 20%. Now, I don't have that slide right now. India, how much it would be? Since today, it is 3%. And it was not much more pre-91 either. Okay? Because first of all, of course, the industrial sector itself, the organized industrial sector itself is a very small segment of the Indian economy. If you look at the employment is concerned, both pre-91 and post-91. Okay. It's agriculture, then there are services and so on, which predominate in terms of the employment. Now, so right away you see that large number of countries which are supposed to be all capitalist actually have many more people working in the public sector, number one. Number two, another, let's look at another criterion. What is the intervention of the government in the economy? Andhra, how dominating is the government in the economy? Means how much is the government spending as a ratio of the GDP? Then you get even more surprised. Every large, what we call not only large, but advanced economy, that is, they may be size-wise smaller. Like, for example, if you many countries in the world, in Europe, India is number five, number six, only because the total GDP is large. But if you look at per capita, there are many small countries which are at higher per capita than India. In fact, recently in the last year, even Bangladesh went ahead of India per capita. Okay, Sri Lanka was already ahead of India per capita. And then per person yesterday, the average noted. Okay, so again, what are called rich countries? Okay. And none of them call themselves socialists, or nobody calls them socialists, even outsiders. They all have government spending to GDP ratio of anywhere from 40 to 60%, and some even up to 70% in the case of France. In the United States itself is about, I think, 57% or something like that, above 50. All the major economies, more than 50% of the economy is actually due to government spending. And what is it in India? It used to be 5% and now it has reached 30%. Okay, it has been increasing. So that the government's role in the economy, government spending, determines whether the country is socialist or not is again a false impression and so on. Now, I'll come to licensing and MRTP and all these things later. Let me look at what actually, how, who played what role in the economy in India, in actually shaping that economy, in giving a direction to the economy and all that. Many people think, oh, there were some leftists sitting with Nehru and they were influenced by Soviet Union. Mal Nobis was greatly impressed by central planning in Soviet Union, etc., etc. And that's how we got fire plans. And since fire plans were being used in Soviet Union, so we also became socialist. Okay. Now, what I would like to share with you is parts of a document. This document was issued even before independence, 3 years before independence. It started in December 1944 and ended in, volume one came in December 1944 and volume two came in January 1945. Okay. And the authors of this document, it is a public document. It is freely available. You can even download it from the net. And in fact, 75th anniversary of that document took place last year. And several volumes have come out in that. I might give you some references for that. on the, and this document is what is commonly called Bombay Plan. Okay, it is actually, its formal name was Plan for a Plan for India's Economic Development. Okay, part one came out in 44 and part two came in 45. And who were the authors? Not members of CPI, not members of Socialist Party, not even members of Congress Party. The authors were J.R.D. Tata, G.D. Birla, Lala Shriram, who was the founder of the DCM group, Kasturbhai Lalbhai, who was a major, who was the head of Lalbhai group, which was a major group from Ahmedabad. There was Purushottam Das Thakur Das from Mumbai. Okay, and so on. There were some seven or eight, Ardeshir Dalal and two, three others. Okay, you may not have heard of their name, but the most prominent people in that, who played the major role in even getting the others together in this endeavor, were G.D. Birla and J.R.D. Tata. Okay, so if you look at that, you see how they chart out the economy, what is their wish list, okay? How should Indian economy be organized? They spell it out, especially in the second volume, which is called Role of the State. Okay? It's called Role of the State. In Plan for India's Economic Development, Part 2, Role of the State. Okay? So I'll just show you some highlights from that. Please, I strongly advise you all to download it from the net and look at it if you can't access the couple of books which have come out recently on that. But it is a historic document. Okay, now I'm going to list out just a few sections from that. So which tells you who shaped licensing, who shaped public sector, who shaped ban on foreign capital, who shaped ban on foreign goods coming into India, and except through very high custom duty and so on and so forth, which created a so-called protected market for India. Okay. This is just one section of that document. Okay, this is section 46. So not only generally talks about controls that should be there, but it talks specifically controls. These controls will operate, that is controls by the state, will operate mainly in the following spheres: production, distribution, consumption, investment, foreign trade and exchange, and wages and working conditions. All these will be determined by the government. And this was a plan proposed by G.D. Birla and J.R.D. Tata, a group led by them. In fact, Bombay Plan is just a short form for this used by many academics, but ordinary people started calling it Tata Birla Plan, right in the 40s. Okay. Now, let's look at other parts of this. Then it goes on to say, control of production. Control of production will aim at a proper allocation of resources so as to secure better regional distribution of economic enterprises. Okay, so the government will control everything, not only where it, what should be built where, and who should own it, and who should be licensed. Okay, because it says control will operate chiefly through system of licenses. So in the public, the same people later went and used to rant and rave about, oh, how there is license raj here, permit raj here, there is inspector raj here, and so on. So and many academics followed that and say, oh, what is in India is a license raj, it's not capitalism. But here you are the biggest capitalist in India. They were the biggest capitalists, even in the colonial India. Even when the British were ruling India, the British capital was displaced by the Tatas, Birlas, Giants and Dalmias, and so on, in industry, in banking, in insurance, way back in 39-40 itself. In fact, this whole movement of dominance of the Indian capital started soon after the First World War. And you can... you can make your own connection. That is a separate lecture altogether on how this interacted with the freedom movement, how it reshaped the freedom movement from 1919 onwards, and what role these capitalists played in the freedom movement. Behind, okay, obviously, mostly they were behind the freedom movement, not in front as leaders. In front, leaders were various other people. It could be Gandhi, Bose, Nehru, Vallabhbhai Patel, etc., etc. Okay, but how these capitalists interacted with it, funded it, supported it, even determined the agenda of the freedom movement at various, continuously, literally, while on the other hand, sitting also with the Viceroy and negotiating with him terms for freedom for India. That is a separate lectures. Okay, there is a separate discussion. I'll not go into that here. But the point is, it is these, by then the 39-40, that displaced foreign capital, that is, which was predominantly British capital at that time, from industry and large industry, small industry anyway was under Indian control, as well as from banking, insurance, and so on and so forth. Okay. So now it is they who are saying there should be licensing. It is they who are saying government sector should be there. Not only that, government regulation should be there. Okay. Distribution will be controlled primarily with the object of determining priorities of release of raw materials. See, even who should get coal, who should get what, who should get iron ore, who should get bauxite for aluminum, everything will be determined by the government. Okay. Rationing and distribution of consumer goods. Rationing was already there in the Second World War. British had started it because there was a shortage. And they said, now we should set up a whole system of rationing. And the rationing should continue as a control of the state or consumption so that some people will not corner it and so on. Okay. The objective to be kept in view in controlling consumption will be to enforce fair selling prices for essential goods and to prevent inflation. Why all this? To prevent inflation. Because the moment there is a high inflation, many things happen. Not only the rich get richer, poor get poorer, but also the exchange rate, the rupee value falls down. Okay, so overall, the rupee starts sliding down with respect to other foreign currencies, whether it is pound sterling or that time pound sterling was dominant and dollar became even more dominant later. And so that is the reason they said we should prevent inflation. Also, inflation leads to agitation among people for higher salaries, higher wages. So strikes, all these things start, agitation starts. So they said, no, you should control inflation. If not prevent it, at least control inflation. Okay, so the government should do this. Now, next slide. I'm continuing it. As regards investment control, new capital issues should be approved by the state. Okay, that means if you want to float a company and float shares for that company, you are not free to do it unless the government approves. So they established what was called Controller of Capital Issues, CCI, at that time. And this is being proposed by the biggest capitalist. Okay? Not by any socialist, any communist, anybody else. Why they did all this? We'll come to that. How this actually led to the growth, even bigger growth of monopolies, even bigger dominance of the Indian economy by few groups, right from the which had started earlier even under British rule, which continued later at a greater pace. Because now they could have the country complete control over state power. Because these people, in fact, it will be interesting that the people who fought for and established Reserve Bank of India to control all the banks were not British or not independent India. It was Tatas and Birlas. They started an agitation with the British government saying there should be Reserve Bank of India, which will control the monetary policy, which will control the exchange policy, foreign exchange policy, and so on and so forth, way back in 24-25. And finally, they forced the British government to establish the Reserve Bank of India in 1935. And not only that, since that day, from 1934-35 to this day, representatives of Tatas and Birlas are sitting on the board of governors of Reserve Bank of India. Every year. Okay. The very initially, there were some British governors of Reserve Bank of India. But soon, in the 40s, they were able to bring in the first first Indian was ICS officer was established as the governor of Reserve Bank of India. Who was that? It was Chintamani Deshmukh, C.D. Deshmukh, who also became a famous finance minister under Nehru and so on. He was a brilliant economist, a brilliant student of economics in Cambridge who had joined ICS. And he was appointed by as the governor of Reserve Bank of India, primarily because of the lobbying done by Tatas and Birlas under British rule. Okay, not only that, interesting, in 1944-45, when the Bretton Woods Conference, I don't know how many of you are familiar with it, Bretton Woods Conference took place near Washington, D.C. in 1944-45, which actually established the World Bank and the IMF. And in that, actually in that Bretton Woods Conference, Tatas and Birlas attended that conference and lobbied for how World Bank should operate. Okay, what should be the governing principles of World Bank? And even lobbied, they tried their best to make C.D. Chintamani Deshmukh, C.D. Deshmukh as the first managing director of IMF. Okay. But obviously the Americans didn't want to give up control. So despite all the lobbying, they were not successful. And to this day, IMF is still has been completely under the control of America. Whereas they're ready to put an European choice for the World Bank. But for IMF, the Americans are in full control. Okay. But I mean, to that extent, the Tatas and Birlas operated even internationally. They participated in the first trade agreements which were taking place in the 40s, which later became GATT and WTO and all that. Even the arguments to be given there, how India should argue its case, what should be the agenda, all that was determined by them. In fact, Singhania wrote, J.K. Singhania was head of the J.K. group, which is one of the large groups. And at that time was even larger than what it is now. In fact, wrote the argument that India should make in the World Trade Organizations. And to this day, the government of India follows that more or less, that that agenda, okay, that major agenda. So anyway, so it is they who established what is called, you can say, said that we should have a controller of capital issues for the stock market. Trade and exchange will be subjected to control to such an extent as to be required for conserving foreign exchange. See, so foreign exchange should not be free for everybody. Government should control who should get how much foreign exchange. See, we all used to say, oh, now it is free. Now you can send money abroad. You can, even send your children abroad, even if you are rich enough. Okay. And you can buy dollars. Whereas when we went to study, we were given only $8 by the RBI. $8 was all that you could take from India to go and study abroad, which obviously meant that not only you should get scholarships abroad, most people, unless you're a son of, you belong to the rich class, then you can make other arrangements, both through the government and otherwise. To fund your education. And that's how you would see initially the graduates of MIT and many other institutions abroad were mostly from the capitalist families from India. Okay. Kirloskar studied in MIT, Baba Kalyani studied in MIT, Firodia of the Kinetic Group studied in MIT. All these people were sent abroad, not through scholarship, but by their parents. In fact, Mukesh Ambani studied in Stanford. Anil Ambani studied in Wharton. Wharton is one of the leading schools in America, and so on and so forth. Okay, that's only such people could afford foreign education. But so everybody had to go through, had to not only have to be qualified enough, bright enough to get a scholarship, but even then the government will release only $8 at that time. So all these restrictions. Not only that, even to buy an instrument for your lab or a computer, when the computer started in the 50s, you want to get a computer that you have to buy from abroad, right? So you need foreign exchange. So that foreign exchange was completely controlled by the government, right? We know all that. But that controls were actually suggested by the Tatas and Birlas in the Bombay Plan for conserving foreign exchange and for protecting Indian industries. To protect Indian industries also, ಓಕೆ ಸೊ ದಟ್ ಯು ಡೋಂಟ್ ಅಲೌ ಫಾರಿನ್ ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲ್ ಟು ಕಮ್ ಇನ್ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಆಫ್ ವೇಜಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ವರ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಕಂಡೀಷನ್ಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಏಮ್ ಅಟ್ ಫೇರ್ ಕಂಡೀಷನ್ಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ಲೇಬರ್ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಮೋರ್ ಆರ್ ಲೆಸ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸೇ ಲಿಪ್ ಸರ್ವಿಸ್ ಟು ಲೇಬರ್ ಕಂಡೀಷನ್ಸ್ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಕಮ್ ಟು ದಿಸ್ ಲೇಟರ್ ಬಟ್ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಡಾಕ್ಯುಮೆಂಟ್ ಈಸ್ ವೈಲ್ ಇಟ್ ಪ್ರಪೋಸ್ ದಟ್ ದರ್ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಸೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದರ್ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ನಾಟ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಸೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಸರ್ಟನ್ ಇಂಡಸ್ಟ್ರೀಸ್ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ರಿಸರ್ವ್ ಫಾರ್ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಸೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಸೋ ಆನ್ ಸೋ ಫೋರ್ ಇಟ್ ಈವನ್ ಸೆಡ್ ದಟ್ ಇನ್ ಫ್ಯೂಚರ್ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಪ್ರೈವೇಟೈಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಸೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಇಮ್ಯಾಜಿನ್ ದಟ್ ದೇರ್ ಫೋರ್ ಸೈಟ್ ದೇ ರೋಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಇನ್ 1944-45 ಫಸ್ಟ್ ದ ಟ್ಯಾಕ್ಸ್ ಪೇಯರ್ಸ್ ಮನಿ ದ ರಿಸೋರ್ಸಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಸೊಸೈಟಿ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ಬಿಲ್ಡ್ ಅಪ್ ಅ ಪಬ್ಲಿಕ್ ಸೆಕ್ಟರ್ which will create the infrastructure for the private sector to grow, okay, which will create the fencing for the private sector to operate here with large profits and not come under any competition from foreign competitors for 30-40 years. And it's only when they were strong enough, they themselves propose that now we should globalize. So the globalization, impulse to globalize, was actually coming from the big capitalists in India, not from any so-called World Bank pressure or IMF pressure, which many people think, you know, this Americans and IMF and World Bank put the pressure. It was actually the pressure was put by Indian capitalists on the government for liberalization. They had been lobbying for it, in fact, under Mrs. Gandhi itself, but they were successful with Narasimha Rao and Manmohan Singh when there was an economic crisis to liberalize and open up the markets. And the reason was simple. Reason was by that time they were strong enough that they wanted to go global. They wanted to go and buy factories outside. They wanted to buy companies outside. They wanted to invest in other economies. At that time, the other economy said, how can you come in and invest in our economy unless you open up your economy? Okay. It has to happen two ways. It's not a one-way street. It's a two-way street. If you want to come and buy our companies, okay, like today, Tata's own Jaguar and Land Rover and Corus and the Birla's own the biggest aluminum companies in America. Okay, and so on and so forth. Many companies have, in fact, per year, today, Indian capitalists are buying anywhere between 700 to 800 foreign companies. They are buying foreign companies. This is Reserve Bank data. And this is not now. This is the data from 2003-04 onwards. Every year, nearly 750 to 800 companies are being bought by the Indian capitalists. And in fact, Indian capitalists, way 10 years ago, I'm not giving you the latest data, 2010 data is that Indian capitalists have already invested more than $75 billion abroad. We only talk about foreign money coming in. Okay, that foreigners are coming and, you know, investing in India. Indians are also going abroad and investing. Okay, Indian capitalists, that is. So that is what is meant by globalization. And they wanted that. That is the reason they pushed the government to modify their earlier restrictions and open up for both foreign goods as well as foreign capital. Okay, so that they can also go out and invest abroad. But this issue of privatization, which started in the 90s and later in 2000, and now also it's going on, continuing, these public sector assets which were created, now they should be privatized. First with industry and now with banks, insurance, and various other things. That also was actually put down in this document. See this, section 41. It says, if later on, private finance is prepared to take over these industries, state ownership may be replaced by private ownership. Very interesting, isn't it? Okay. Now, let's go to the next one. What was the impact of this? That is very interesting. Impact of Bombay plan. You can say, oh, anybody can write a plan. But did the government follow it? First of all, government immediately adopted it. If you look at the 1948 Industrial Policy Resolution and later, which was modified in 1956, it uses some socialism and this, some equity and justice and all that words here and there. But essentially, it takes all the elements of the Bombay plan. Now, I'll give you the best testimonial for the Bombay plan was actually given by Dr. Manmohan Singh in 2004 when he was a prime minister. It was a centenary of GRD Tata in which he was speaking. And Dr. Manmohan Singh surely knows something about the economy. After all, he was a Reserve Bank governor, he was finance secretary, he was the vice chairman of the planning commission, and later finance minister and even prime minister. Okay, if anybody knows anything about Indian economy, probably the most knowledgeable person is today still alive is Dr. Manmohan Singh. And you know what he says? I'm just going to read out what he said in his speech. You can go to the PMO website and download that speech, the speech he gave in 2004. Okay, this is all. None of this, what I'm presenting you, is any kind of a conspiracy theory or some hidden, you know, something that I have discovered. All this is in the public domain. Only you need to invest time and effort in investigating it to see how actually who shaped it, who is actually running the show. Okay, it's not Nehru, Indira Gandhi, or even Modi. It is the capitalists which are running the show. That is the conclusion finally you come to. Because you see here what Dr. Manmohan Singh said. He said, as a student of economics in the 1950s and later, as a practitioner in government, I was greatly impressed by the Bombay Plan of 1944. When we read it today, nearly 60 years later, we see how relevant many of the central propositions of the Bombay Plan remain. In those days, it was an unprecedented document. It is worth the placing emphasis that nowhere in the developing world had a group of businessmen come together to draw up such a long-term plan for a country. Next, he said, the Bombay Plan laid great emphasis on public investment in social and economic infrastructure in both rural and urban areas. It emphasized the importance of agrarian reform and agricultural research in setting up educational institutions like IITs, IIMs, etc., which were later became IITs and IIMs, and modern financial system. Okay, today India has one of the most modern financial systems. In fact, many other countries, its stock markets, its banking systems, and so on, its corporate ministry, how it deals with the corporations and registration of companies and all that. Many, many foreign country delegations come here to study. In fact, Chinese used to come here, Russians used to come here and so on to study our stock exchanges and banks and so on after we built them in the 90s and 2000. Okay. India was in the forefront of the modernization of the finance sector and quickly caught up with the United States and so on. That is one of the reasons why you find a lot of Indians, not only in Silicon Valley, but also in the financial sector all over the world, whether it is Singapore, Hong Kong, London, or the Wall Street in the New York. It is a very large number of Indians are there from top to bottom in the various, as with various responsibilities. Anyway, that is because they're also already trained in the management and in the systems of the modern financial system. So he says there, that modernization of agriculture, modernization of education, modernization of financial system, all of it was laid out in the Bombay Plan, he says. And moreover, he says, above all, it defined the framework for India's transition from agrarian feudalism to industrial capitalism. And please remember the last sentence of this para. In many ways, it encapsulates what all subsequent five-year plans have tried to achieve. Okay? So imagine, people used to think five-year plan meant socialism. Okay? Here, basically, five-year plans were made and implemented to create the necessary public spending and finance and infrastructure for the private capital to grow and become stronger. Okay? So every single, he says, what all subsequent five-year plans tried to achieve was actually encapsulated in the Bombay Plan. Okay, now let's look at this issue which we were discussing earlier. License Raj, especially under Indira Gandhi, 69 to 72, 73, the things which were done, which were called socialist, that is bank and insurance nationalization, License Raj and MRTP. Now I'll take only, there's not much time left, because I want to give at least 10 minutes for discussion. So I want to finish it in 5 minutes. So I'll just show you one more slide, only about the License Raj. Okay, this is the data. So this is the data collected in 1983. Okay, I have given the reference below, Corporate Studies Group report. So it shows who got these licenses and how these licenses were used. So if you see, maximum number of 220 licenses were cornered by Birla, 198 licenses were cornered by Tata, 35 licenses were cornered by Mofatlal, 35 licenses were cornered by Singhania, and 43 licenses were cornered by Thapar Group. These were the top five. Okay. And other, why did they want licensing? Number one, they could lobby and get all the major number of licenses. Not only that, they would also prevent their competitors from getting that license. Because once a license is given for one particular industry, nobody else can put up a factory in that. Nobody else, their application will be rejected. Okay. So not only they got 220 licenses, for example, Birla's, but 50 of those 220, they didn't even implement them. 0% implementation. 38 only quarter implementation. 39 only half implementation. Okay. Out of 220, only 52 where you can say properly implemented. That means 150 or 170 people, competitors, were blocked by Birla. Okay. Similarly, if you go look at the Tatas, out of the 198 licenses they received by 1983, from 47 to 1983, only 31 they operated. Rest were, you can say, blocked for others to enter. Same thing with Mofatlals and Singhanias and Thapars and so on. So you can see why they set up this licensing. On the one hand, it looks like government is controlling capitalism, but actually it is leading to monopolizers. It is leading to certain groups cornering the licenses and then creating a monopoly so that nobody else can enter that sector. Now, if you look at bank and insurance nationalization, I'm not going to go into this now because there's no time. You will see the same thing. It sounded very socialist. Why? Because there were many, many banks at that time, private, and other than State Bank of India, everything else was under private ownership. Okay. So Tata had one small bank called Central Bank. Birla had another bank. I think it was called Union Bank or Union Cooperative Bank, something like that. Okay, UCO or something like that. So they were also nationalized. So it looked like, oh, the government is now acting against Tata and Birla's. Okay. But these were small banks. And these people were sitting, and who is controlling all the banks, both nationalized and unnationalized? Reserve Bank of India. And who is sitting on the governing board of Reserve Bank of India? It is Tatas and Birlas and other big capitalists. Even today, you go and see, okay? Even from 1934-35 to this day, representatives of Tatas and Birlas are sitting in the governing board. J.R.D. Tata was in the RBI governing board. Ratan Tata was in the governing board. Today, even Chandrasekharan, who is the new chairman of the Tata Sons, is sitting in the governing board of RBI. And RBI then determines what is a banking policy, what is a monetary policy, what is a foreign exchange policy, and so on. Okay. So you can see who is controlling the whole policy. They might have lost one small bank, but they gained the whole banking sector. So if you see the rise in assets of these groups, it actually accelerated after 69-70. You can see what were their assets in 69-70 and what was their assets in the 80s and 90s. It is an exponential growth. So if it was a socialism, that the nationalization took place for socialism, then how monopoly capitalism grew under it? All that it did was government funds were put in to create branches in the rural areas and smaller, big branch expansion was done so that people's deposits could be collected. And where do those deposits go? The deposits go to lend to the industry and to government so that the government then spends on the industry and on various projects. Okay. So this, the nationalization by itself doesn't mean anything. So most important thing, what I want to say is, when we talk about capitalism, socialism, when you talk about socialism or whatever, it is not state ownership or state control is not the determining factor. What is determining factor is who is controlling the state. Okay. So if the monopolies are controlling the state, then it is not only there from their own business they are making money, but they are controlling the state and hence making even more money. Okay. So this is as far away from socialism as anything else can be. Because socialism is not state ownership. That is called statism. Okay, that state should intervene, state should play a major role, state should own, state should control. All that is called statism. It is not socialism. Anyway, so at this point, I want to end this so that we'll have 10 more minutes for discussion. Thank you very much. Okay, so how do we do the discussion?
Stop sharing and stop moderating.
Okay.
Do the stop sharing. Okay. Anybody has some questions? Yeah, or comments? You agree, you don't agree? Okay. Sharad, while people are thinking, I just wanted to ask you my own view on this. What are you trying to say? It was a conspiracy by these industrialists to make sure that their business grew well while India was growing before they can face international competition? Or was it the right way to go about because of the economic condition of India?
Okay, first of all, We can't call this a conspiracy because conspiracy has to be secret.
Yeah.
This was published and sold for, two annas or four annas or something like that in 1944. Okay. One rupee in 1944. And now anyway, you can download it. So it is not a conspiracy at all. Okay. It was a plan. It was actually a plan. They called it the plan for the nation and plan for the development of India. Okay. You can say, yes, it was a plan for development of India, but more importantly, it was a plan for their own growth also. Okay. So as a result of that, what we see is that you can say, if you were a follower of trickle-down effect, then of course things have improved. Of course, maybe Tata's became multi billionaires. Tata's and Birla's, and now you have Ambani's and the others like even Adani's and so on and so forth. Many, many multi billionaires. In fact, there is a latest statistics that is coming up. Sorry. Just one second. Main baad mein phone karunga. So, just statistics has come just during the corona. Okay. How many? 223 million people have been pushed in the poverty line, who have come above poverty line, have been pushed down into poverty line. But 50 more billionaires have been created. Okay. So you can say we have progressed. Some people who are looking only at the billionaire list will say India is progressing. India is becoming this power, that power. We are buying, billions of dollars worth of arms. So on and so forth, so many prime ministers and presidents come to India to sell their goods, sell their arms or whatever. So we have become a great power. On the other hand, if we talk about a nation and national development, you'll have to look at what are our indicators. You look at our health indicators, our gross enrollment ratio indicators. We look at other social indicators. We are even behind Sri Lanka.
Yeah.
And in some cases, behind Bangladesh.
Bangladesh.
Okay.
Correct. I agree.
What can be more shameful than that?
That is right. No, my question was like that. Means did they use the socialistic instruments? Okay. The industrialists use the socialistic instruments to protect their, or to support their own growth before they faced international competition.
Yeah, very much. The only thing is they didn't call it socialistic. All the so-called other political analysts and political parties called it socialistic. Called it socialistic.
But they were socialistic, right? The moves were socialistic.
No, not at all. Socialism means against capitalism. Okay. So these were moves. That's why I'm emphasizing.
Okay.
They're not written by some communists. It was written by the biggest capitalists.
Yeah.
Okay.
Very good.
Number one. Mm. And no, forget about authorship. Mm. But even the end result we see, who grew up with that?
Correct.
Okay, who benefited from it?
Okay, anybody else has questions? B.R. Patil, madam, you had something? Geetarani, yeah. Geetarani is asking one question and after that we'll go to Shivlingaya. Yeah, Geetarani.
Okay, only one thing I want to say related to what you asked. In fact, Mrs. Gandhi, see, that socialism is such a word, everybody loves to use it. Even Hitler used it. Okay, everybody uses it. Even today, like the Prime Minister Modi always talks about Sabka Vikas, you know, and Sabka Vishwas, and you know, for the poor, for
the lack of time. Let me ask, madam.
So Mrs. Gandhi in an interview said to a French TV that in a poor country, if you are do not appear leftist, then you can't survive, you can't get elected. Simple, it doesn't matter which party you belong to.
Correct, Keli madam, Keli madam.
Sir, Kanvi sir, aurige namaskara, sir.
Namaskara.
ಸರ್ ಇಲ್ಲಿವರೆಗೂ ಏನ್ 1 hour ನೀವು ಹೇಳಿದಿರಿ, ಅದು ಹೇಗಿತ್ತು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಎಳೆ ಎಳೆ ಆಗಿ ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶದ ಒಂದು ಆರ್ಥಿಕ ಸ್ಥಿತಿ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ನೀವು ಬಹಳ ಪ್ರಸ್ತುತವಾಗಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ಯಾವುದು ಕೂಡ ಮುಚ್ಚಿಟ್ಟಿಲ್ಲ, ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಸೋಷಲಿಸಂ ಆಗಿರ್ಬಹುದು ಅಥವಾ ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಆಗಿರ್ಬಹುದು ಯಾವುದು ಮುಚ್ಚಿಟ್ಟಿಲ್ಲ ಸರ್. ನಾವು ಇತ್ತೀಚೆಗೆ ರೈತರ ಹೋರಾಟ ಕೂಡ ಇದಕ್ಕೆ ಬಹಳ ಏನು ಬಹಳ ಸಮೀಪದಲ್ಲಿದೆ ಸರ್. ಹೆಂಗಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಈಗ ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾರ ಪರವಾಗಿದೆ ಈ ಒಂದು ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು ಅಥವಾ ಎಕಾನಮಿ ಆಗಿರ್ಬೋದು, ಇದು ಯಾರ ಪರವಾಗಿದೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ನಮ್ಮ ರೈತರು ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಸರ್. ಬಟ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ವೆಲ್ ಎಜುಕೇಟೆಡ್ ನಾವು ಮತ್ತೆ ಲೇಬರ್ ಕ್ಲಾಸ್, ಆ ಲೇಬರ್ ಕ್ಲಾಸಿಗೆ ಕೂಡ ಇದು ಸರಿಯಾದಂತ ಒಂದು ಮಾಹಿತಿ ಇಲ್ಲ ಸರ್. ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಇದು ರೈತರಿಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗಿದೆ ಸರ್, ಡೂ ಆರ್ ಡೈ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಗೊತ್ತಾಗಿದೆ. ಗೊತ್ತಾಗಿ ಅವರು ಹಿಸ್ಟಾರಿಕಲ್ ಮೂವ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇವತ್ತು ಕೂಡ ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಕೂಡ ನಾವು ಇಡೀ ಜಗತ್ತೇ ಕೂಡ ಏನ್ ಮಾಡಿದೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್ ಹೇಳಿದೆ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು.
ಸಾರಿ ಫಾರ್ ದಿ ಇಂಟರಪ್ಷನ್, ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕ್ವಿಕ್ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ ಕೇಳಿ, ಇಲ್ಲದಿದ್ರೆ ಟೈಮ್ ಇಲ್ಲಲ್ಲ, ಅದರಿಂದ ಒಂದು ಶಾರ್ಟ್ ಆಗಿ ಕ್ವೆಶನ್ ಕೇಳಿ ಅವ್ರ ಆನ್ಸರ್.
ಓಕೆ ಸರ್, ಬಟ್ ನಮ್ಗೆ ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಇನ್ನೂ ಕೂಡ ಇದೇ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಂಡಿದೀವಿ, ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶ ಒಂದು ಸೋಷಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ. ನೀವು ಬಹಳ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಪರೆಂಟ್ ಆಗಿ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರಿ, ಇದು ಸೋಷಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ನೂ ಅಲ್ಲ, ಮತ್ತೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಇದು ಕಮ್ಯುನಿಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ನೂ ಅಲ್ಲ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಬಹಳ ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಆಗಿ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರಿ ಸರ್. ಇದು ಇನ್ನೂ ಹೆಚ್ಚೆಚ್ಚಾಗಿ ನಿಮ್ಮಂತ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ತಿಳುವಳಿಕೆ ಇರುವಂತ ಮತ್ತು ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಜ್ಞಾನಿಗಳು ನಮ್ಮ ಸಾಮಾನ್ಯ ಜನರಿಗೆ ಇದು ತಿಳಿಸ್ಬೇಕಂತ ನನ್ನೊಂದು ಕೋರಿಕೆ ಇದೆ ಸರ್.
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು, ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಇನ್ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ ನನ್ನ ಹೆಸರು ಹಾಕಿದ ಕೂಡಲೇ ಮೊದಲು ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ಸಜೆಸ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದು ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಪ್ರಸಾದ್ ಅವರು ಬಾಂಬೆ ಪ್ಲಾನ್ ಅಂತ. ಓಕೆ, ನಾನು ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಒಂದು ಸ್ಪಿನ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟು ನೆಹರು ಇಂದಿರಾ ಗಾಂಧಿ ಹೆಸರು ಹಾಕಿದೆ. ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಬಾಂಬೆ ಪ್ಲಾನ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಏನಪ್ಪ ಏನ್ ಮಾತಾಡ್ತಾನೆ ಇವನು, ಈ ಸಮ್ ಬೋರಿಂಗ್ ಪ್ಲಾನ್, ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಮಸ್ಟ್ ಬಿ ದೇರ್ ಅಂತ ತಿಳ್ಕೋಬಹುದು ಅಂತೇಳಿ ಅದನ್ನ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಟಾಪಿಕಲ್ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ನೆಹರು ಇಂದಿರಾ ಗಾಂಧಿ ಹೆಸರು
ಹಾಕಿದ್ದೇನೆ ಅಷ್ಟೇ. ಸರ್ ಕೇಳಬೇಕಂತಿದ್ರು
ಸರ್. ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಸರ್, ತುಂಬಾ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೇಶನ್ ತುಂಬಾ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿತ್ತು ಸರ್, ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಒಳ್ಳೊಳ್ಳೆ ವಿಷಯನ ಪ್ರಸ್ತಾಪ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರಿ ಸರ್. ಕೇಳಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಾ?
ಹಾ
ಸರ್. ಏನಿಲ್ಲ, ನಂದೊಂದೇ ಒಂದು ಸಣ್ಣ ಡೌಟ್ ಬಂತು ಸರ್, ಈ ಸೋಷಿಯಲಿಸಂ ಮೇಲೆ ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲ್ ಒಂದೇ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಇನ್ಫ್ಲುಯೆನ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡುತ್ತಾ ಅಥವಾ ಅದರ್ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟರ್ಸ್, ಇಟ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ರಿಲಿಜಿಯನ್ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು, ಕಲ್ಚರ್ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು, ರೀಜನಲಿಸಂ ಆಗ್ಬೋದು. ಯಾಕೆಂದ್ರೆ ಬಾಂಬೆ ಪ್ಲಾನ್ ಅಂದಾಗ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ರೀಜನಲಿಸಂ ಅನ್ನೋದು ಒಂದು ಸಣ್ಣ ಇದು ಬಂತು, ನನ್ಗೆ ಆಲೋಚನೆ ಬಂತು. ಸೊ ಈ ತರದ ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟರ್ಸ್ ಯಾಕೆ ಎಷ್ಟು ಮಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಎಫೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ?
ಓಕೆ, ಸಿ ನಾನು ಒಂದೇ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಹೇಳ್ಬೇಕಂದ್ರೆ, ಇದು ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಆಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ ಸೋಷಿಯಲಿಸಂ, ಬೇರೆ ಬೇರೆ ಆಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ಸ್ ಇದೆ, ಆಸ್ ಎ ಫಿಲಾಸಫಿ, ಆಸ್ ಎ ಸೋಷಿಯಲ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್, ಆಸ್ ಎ ಪೊಲಿಟಿಕಲ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್, ಇಕನಾಮಿಕ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಎಟ್ಸೆಟ್ರಾ. ಬಟ್ ದ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಕ್ರೂಷಿಯಲ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಫರ್ಗಾಟನ್ ಇಸ್ ದಟ್ ಸೋಷಿಯಲಿಸಂ whether a system is socialist or not depends on what is the role of the people in the system. Okay, if the people are marginalized and some minority is ruling it, they are controlling it, they can even call themselves communist party. Okay, that doesn't make it socialist at all. So today, in fact, if you look at the billionaire list in China, many of them are connected to the Chinese Communist Party, their relatives and so on and so forth. Same thing happened in Russia even before Putin and other people came in. You know, the people in the Russian Communist Party had become the controllers of the society, and they had the say. Ordinary people didn't have the say. They might have got some free education and free health and things like that. That can be organized if you have enough wealth in a society. Sweden has it. Sweden looks after free education till PhD. Okay. My cousin stays there. He was telling me, of course, they charge 53% tax, income tax. But doesn't matter. He says, I don't have to worry about anything. Health and education is taken care. Okay. So that is not the, and today, of course, when there is a crisis, they are trying to cut everything, cut all the government spending on any kind of social sector, or in all countries, Canada, UK, United States, Sweden, everywhere, there's a pressure to cut things.
Okay. We have time for one last question.
That's why one thing I want to say is that when you talk about state controlling various, the state organizing the society, the most important question is, who is controlling the state? Are people controlling the state? Is a state accountable to people, or is to a small group of monopoly capitals?
Another question. Anybody else wants to ask a question or a comment, whatever. The question. B R Patil madam, you know, chat all hakidre. Adana, you want to repeat that?
Time I can't
remember. Okay.
No, sir. I have already written that.
You already written it. Yeah, you can express it also in words if you like. Last chance, Patil madam.
ಬಹಳ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಿದಿರಿ ಸರ್ ಸೋಷಿಯಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲಿಸಂ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಇನ್ ದ ನೇಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಸೋಷಿಯಲಿಸಂ ಯಾವ ರೀತಿ ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಗೆ ಫೇವರ್ ಆಗಿ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಎಕಾನಮಿ ಪ್ಲಾನ್ ಆಯ್ತು ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನ ಅಂಡ್ ಇಫ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ನಾಟ್ ರಾಂಗ್ ಸರ್ ಮೇ ಬಿ ಅಗ್ರಿ ವಿತ್ ಮೀ ಇನ್ ಒನ್ ಆರ್ ದಿ ಅದರ್ ವೇ ಆಲ್ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಆಲ್ ಗವರ್ನಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಡೂಯಿಂಗ್ ದ ಸೇಮ್
ಅಬ್ಸಲ್ಯೂಟ್ಲಿ Not only that, initially in 1951, I think in the Audi Congress, that the Congress adopted this formally saying we will go towards socialistic pattern of society. Okay. But later, Mrs. Gandhi during emergency even amended the constitution and called India, which was a secular democratic republic, she called it secular socialist democratic republic. Okay. And that socialist in the constitution has not been removed by any government. Okay. Including Prime Minister Modi so far.